I'm Mike.
And I'm Russell.
And welcome to Joy TV, where the joy of the Lord is your strength. And I just want to welcome you and thank you for tuning in to the 2016 Thanksgiving special. It's crazy. It's already Thanksgiving. It's, man, where did this year go? It just flew by with so many things going on in our lives that we have to be thankful for. And that's going to be the epicenter of what we're talking about. Of course, God, but why are we thankful for what God's doing? What is God doing in our lives, and what do we have to be thankful for? So that's what this whole episode is going to be about, is just being thankful to God and thanking Him for the things that He's doing in our lives. I'm super thankful. I'm crazy thankful. God's been just so good to me this last year, on the job, at home, whether I'm coming, whether I'm going. God is just, He's kept me, He's preserved me, He's blessed me, He's made me feel like I'm on top and rising. I know many times I have talked to you guys before my daughter came, we were praying and we wanted God to bless us in that area. While my wife was pregnant, after my child was born, just told you guys about how thankful I am for what God's doing, and I'm still super thankful because now my little girl, she's taken off, she's grown, she's got a head full of crazy hair and that she gets from her dad, and now she's walking and pretty much running everywhere, and so it's man, it's just such a blessing. I'm so thankful for what God is doing, because the world said that would never happen. This little crazy-haired kid that's running around my house, grabbing everything, that was never supposed to happen. But thankfully for God, He had a different plan for my life. And man, God's just so good. And it boils down to, for me, what I'm super thankful for, as well as the answered prayers. God answers prayers. If you pray to God and you ask Him for something in your life, if you're going through something and you want to talk to God, prayer isn't just asking God for things. It's talking to Him. It's communicating with Him. And that prayer does not go unanswered with God. God receives every single word that you say to Him. He hears everything that we say, no matter what. But if you're talking to Him, there's no doubt whatsoever that God does not hear you. God hears what you're saying.
You encounter people that need prayer, that are desperate and desperate situations in their life. And my brother here told me a story before we did this television show about somebody in desperation where you went to God in prayer for somebody you didn't know.
Yeah, I was driving home and I saw literally smoke coming up from beyond the big huge building that's on the corner here on Sac Avenue. And I saw a ton of smoke coming out, and it was right by where I go home. And fire trucks are going before me, fire trucks were after me. I had to pull over and stop. And as I was passing, fire trucks were loaded on the street, and there's someone's house is on fire. And it was super sad because I saw a lady and she was standing on a car in desperation with a garden hose spraying into her house, trying to get the flames down. And I was like, man, that really hit me in my heart. Like, I felt so bad. But it wasn't like I was helpless. I knew what I could do.
Yeah.
So I went home, and my house is real close, so it wasn't too long. Maybe 30 seconds, and I prayed. And I prayed for this family. I prayed for the families that are connected. I prayed for the firefighters, the neighbors, anybody that may have been affected by the situation, that God keep them, that God keeps them safe, that God, even beyond after the storm is cleared, to keep that family. Because, man, what a tragic thing to happen is to lose your house, or even part of your house, part of your belongings. I know it's just stuff, but still, it's your stuff that God's blessed you with, to have that lost. And so I prayed for that family, and I didn't hear anything on the news that anybody got hurt. Obviously, I would have. It was right around the corner from my house. So, man, I knew God was going to do it. I knew God was going to answer that prayer. Because that's what God does. He keeps His children. He keeps the city of West Sacramento. Every single time that we come into service, we pray for the city of West Sacramento and its people. And so I know that family is, God is with you if you're watching this show. So, man, answered prayers. Pray for yourself. Pray for the people that you know. Pray for the people that you love. And be thankful. Thank God ahead of time for those prayers that are going to be answered. You pray those prayers in faith. My brother, he has a story of answered prayers, a crazy story of prayers that he prayed being answered.
Yeah, our last television show is titled The Absolute Truth. And before I get into the absolute truth and what that means, firstly, I just want to echo the same sentiments as my brother here of just thankfulness. Thankfulness for the city, thankfulness for all the police and the fire departments and our government officials, thankfulness for you guys, and I'm thanking God for you guys being there on the other side of the camera and watching Joy TV and hearing all the people that yell at me from the street because they saw me on Joy TV, which is crazy. It's kind of, it holds me to another level of accountability, which I don't, it's kind of weird, but it's you know, I know that I'm blessing people because I'm hearing it. But I just want to thank you. And I just want to say that by watching this television show and consuming the Word of God, not only in with the Bible in your lap, but consuming the Word of God with us here on this television show, you're investing in yourself. Which is the least selfish thing you can do as far as an investment in yourself, because what you're doing is you're building yourself up in the Word. So then when you do face those trying, testing times, like the example my brother gave about the woman whose house was burning down, that you know where your faith lies and where your focus is. And in my, this last television show, I challenge you to go back to that television show. I'm sure it's somewhere close to this one if you're looking online. And you look at that last 5 minutes of the show, and I had it on my heart for a week to pray for the people that were watching and the people around me, that there was a dark despair, a feeling of a situation that they might have been in or were in that went past the kind of the surfacey offenses that we face in a day, day-to-day basis, or maybe even financial woes, where those are seasonal things in our life. And I also prayed for myself. And I can tell you right then, I wasn't going through what I was talking about. But in the time between that television show that was recorded and now, I went through some of the darkest days of my life, and as a minister of God, we make ourselves vulnerable. So here you go. Here I go. Is about a few weeks ago, we took my daughter in. She wasn't feeling very good. She seemed like she was very uncomfortable to the touch of her body, under her armpits, around her neck. It looked like a diaper rash. She's 2 years old, going on 2.5. It looked like a diaper rash. Got a red around her neck. And she just was out of sorts. So we took her to the urgent care, and immediately they said, we need to take you to the emergency room just to make sure. Well, that night they wrote it off as kind of a allergic reaction or an autoimmune type of reaction to a diaper rash. Well, the next morning was Sunday morning. And my daughter woke up and her eyes were swollen, nearly shut. The pain got worse. It was scary. I've never seen my daughter or many people in such pain and agony and just so different than herself. And at this time, I'm praying to God that this doesn't become worse than what it is. And I'm hoping that I have wisdom in this situation and I'm not a foolish parent. And I know that we need to get up and go to church and we talk about going and putting God first. And I knew I had commitments here. I had commitments to play in the worship band and see all the people that rely on seeing my face for encouragement if they get any. My wife says to me, she says, I'll sit here with our daughter. Her name's Amelia. She's beautiful. And go to church. I'll just sit here with her. And I said, okay, well, I started to feel like that we're probably making a foolish decision, but I said, okay, well, that's a good compromise. And I immediately felt out my spirit to say, no, I will not be foolish in this situation. And I went to God in prayer and I felt compelled to say, no, you're going to take her back to the doctors. I'm going to fulfill my commitments at the house in the house of God, and I will meet you there. And what I was feeling was proved to be right. My wife took her to the emergency room, and immediately her skin started to melt away. It was probably the closest thing I've ever seen to what the Bible describes as leprosy, just skin melting away to the touch on her face, on her under her arms, on her where they're putting the IV, and she was in agony. Immediately they put IVs in. As they're trying to put IVs into my daughter, her skin's peeling off. Immediately they say, we need to go and admit you to the hospital. So we stayed in the hospital nearly a week. And I have pictures of the progress of the deterioration of my daughter's physical appearance. And at this moment, or at these moments where I thought that it could go either way, I thought that, you know, there's something here that's either going to, it's going to be a great testimony, or it can go really, really bad. And but either way, God will be glorified in this situation. Either way, it doesn't matter. My daughter could pass away right now and God will still be glorified. And that's a testament to the fact that God gives us his word and we know it's the truth. And at those trying times, it really tells us who we need to lean on. And if you go to Psalm 119, verse 11, and I'll read it right here really fast. Thy word have I hid in mine heart that I might not sin against thee. I'll read it again. Thy word have I hid in mine heart that I might not sin against thee. And at this moment in time, I relied on this scripture because the scripture that we absorb and the scripture that we consume and the encouragement that we hide in our hearts is not for today, I found, but it is for the trials that come in the future. When I opened the Word of God during that period of time in which I did, the revelations came to me during that time, but not like the word that was hidden in my heart. The stuff I studied 2 years ago, 5 years ago, 7 years ago, that came to my remembrance and came to the forefront of my thoughts and really gave me encouragement as well as my wife and my friends and family. At this point, it was Monday and Tuesday, and my daughter couldn't have been worse. And we prayed, we claimed victory over that situation in the name of Jesus. We rebuked the devil out of that situation. We claimed it to be true, and we had hope in that fact. And everything that we claimed, we said, she's going to rise up and she's going to be hungry and she's going to eat. She's going to rise up and she's going to want to drink water and she's going to drink. She's going to rise up and ask for her favorite TV shows. And that's exactly what happened within hours of us claiming that in the name of Jesus. And I fell to my knees the moment that the turnaround happened. Not because of the excitement of, it was part of it, the excitement that things are going to get better, or that it was turning around, is that God was so good and he was answering prayers. And it proved to me at that very moment and everyone around that God is still in control. God is still answering prayers. And if you claim in the name of Jesus, the name above all names, it will happen. And it also proves that in that prayer, in that last television show, that I was not only preparing the people that were out there that needed prayer in that situation, but I was also preparing my spirit. I don't know why, but that was what was on my heart. And that had prepared me. I truly do feel like that it had prepared me. And in that situation, I knew that God was going to be glorified. And today, I get to glorify God in front of you guys, in front of everyone that's here in this room. And in my brother, he saw the situation. And we both glorify God. Me and my wife glorify God in this situation. These are not my daughter's memories. This will not be my daughter's testimony. She won't even remember it. But these are lessons that me, my wife, and my family will be able to learn from for years and years and years to come, for the rest of our lives. My daughter is perfectly normal at this point, and we give glory to God. She's back to eating like a monster and jumping off the walls and driving us up a wall. And though it's long-winded, I wanted to tell you what was real. This is real life TV. This is real. Pastor J.C. Myers, you say, it's like reality TV, just whatever, you know, if you got to scratch your nose, you know? and that's exactly what this is. And I'm making myself, putting myself out there vulnerable so maybe you can learn a lesson. I don't want this, the afflictions that happened to my daughter to be your stumbling block, to be something that goes, well, see what God does, you know, to children or to whoever. That's why I didn't publicize it to anybody. I didn't post it on Facebook. But I knew there was going to be a time which God was going to be glorified. People were going to be encouraged. And maybe, I hope that a soul be saved in this situation. God gets all the glory, and I thank Him. In this Thanksgiving edition of Joy TV, I thank Him. Thank you, Jesus.
Yeah, God's so good. And when you pray to God, that's what gave me so much comfort while our family was going through this, while my little niece was, my daughter's best friend, was going through this. You know, my family got together and prayed, and I just remember Pastor JC teaching me what the Word of God says, is that it's already done. It's already done in the name of Jesus. It's done. It may not have physically happened yet. You might not have seen it come to pass yet, but that's what faith is all about. Things that you haven't seen yet, knowing that they're already done. That's the same faith of Father Abraham, the father of faith. Yeah. That's the same faith he had. And when you pray for things, that's the same faith you're to have if you want them to come to fruition. We had no doubt whatsoever that God was going to be glorified, God was going to be lifted up, and God's will was going to be done in Amelia's life. So, yeah. Man, just so thankful. So, yeah. We'll be right back for a throwback. So you'll see a throwback in here in just a moment. So it's an oldie, but definitely a goodie.
What a treat.
Yep.
What a treat.
You'll enjoy it. We'll be right back.
If you want to be happy, make somebody else happy. And the best way to do that is to be thankful for them. Thank them. If your wife cooks for you, be thankful. Say, thank you, sweetie. If your husband changes the oil on the car or washes the car, say, thank you. Thank you. It's amazing the power that is in being thankful, just thanksgiving, how it touches the hearts and lives of people, especially it touches God when we are thankful. Mike, I want you to share with the people some things that you have here that's going to be a blessing here during this season.
Yeah, I mean, being thankful, especially for Thanksgiving Day, it's now a national holiday. But a lot of times you'll hear it advertised, marketed, talked about as Turkey Day, which is just, you know, what is Turkey Day?
Yeah, gobble, gobble, gobble.
Yeah.
What's that?
Yeah. I mean, we hardly ever eat turkey throughout the year. It's just that one day. Most people don't eat turkey. And so what is Turkey Day? I mean, you think about it. Yeah, you're spending time with your family, which is cool. You get a paid day off usually, most places. You know, your employer's appreciating you for your work. So you get a, you know, paid day off. Everybody likes that. Football game. There's always a football game playing. Usually it seems like every time I watch it, it's the Detroit Lions playing somebody. Hey, those guys always get stuck playing on that day. But it's revolves around other things other than God. And Thanksgiving started out as something that was totally circled around God. It has its roots in faith in the Lord. All the way back when the Pilgrims sailed here from England, they were persecuted heavily for their faith. They didn't want to be a part of a church that had allowed idolatry to infiltrate what was pure and holy. They wanted to maintain true Christianity. They wanted to follow God, and they didn't want men to get in the way. They didn't even want themselves to get in the way.
Well, you know, it grieves a person's heart when they see somebody giving thanks to an idol rather than to God. I know it grieves my heart when somebody doesn't give thanks to God, but they give it to something that is so worthless. And that's where the Pilgrims were, yeah, when they came over. They were just grieved in their heart because God wasn't getting the praise, He wasn't getting the thanks. It was going to some dead idol.
Yeah. And it's just so ridiculous. They took off and they put God before themselves. They got on this, I don't know if you've ever ridden on a boat, but I can't imagine how the boats were back then. I mean, seasickness and all kinds of different things that you experience on riding a boat ride. And those boats are sailboats. They weren't moving like they do now. So, I mean, and they came all the way from England to America. And when they got here, it was not all peaches and cream. They weren't laying out on the beach enjoying stuff. They came and it was rough. They had to find food. They eaten up all the food on the boat, and they came here and they hunted as much as they could. They got some beavers, which actually was part of why they were thankful for that. But they ate up the beavers and they had nothing. And then they're down to those pilgrims. They lost so many friends, family. They lost almost half of who came over, almost half of them died. I mean, brothers, sisters, families, wives, husbands. I mean, it was really rough for those folks. And they were thankful, though. That's one thing that they had, is a thankful heart. They were not ungrateful. They trusted in God. It was they just had faith that God was going to deliver them out of that situation, that God had more for them than what they actually had there on that beach, in that newfound land. Randomly, they had no idea, a merchant ship from some place that's known to have nothing, a merchant ship comes by, loaded with corn and different seeds that they can grow, because at that point they were rationing. They're down to 5 kernels a day for a ration per person. I mean, that's barely living. That's
even a mouse, I don't think it could survive on that.
Yeah, so they were dying. They're on their way out. But God provided, and all those beavers that they ate, well, they saved the pelts from, and that's what they traded. They had nothing. They had no money. They had nothing of value except what God had blessed them with, and they were thankful for that. And they traded. They had abundance after they grew everything. They found a perfect plot of land to where the natives weren't attacking them every time they tried to move off the beach. They found fertile soil. They grew. And they had an abundance, and they were thankful for it. And so that's where Thanksgiving started from. They decided, you know, we're going to thank God. We're going to spend time in prayer. We're going to feast because God has given this to us to enjoy, to praise Him for. And that's when Thanksgiving was started. That's what Thanksgiving is. Realizing and recognizing and thanking God for what He's pulled us up out of.
Yeah.
It's not this glorifying a turkey business. Yeah. It's not this... this whole thing of making a perfect dinner. It's all about glorifying God. That's where the roots are in is Christianity, is faith in God.
You know, we get greater results when we're thankful. When we thank God for what He has given to us or what He has done for us, He so appreciates that He returns that with blessings. I have experienced that personally. Just say, thank you, God. Even in a situation, I have no idea what it feels like to be hungry like the pilgrims were when they came over. I've never experienced that unless I went on a fast, but that was voluntary. Okay, I did that on my own. But I've never experienced what they experienced. But I have experienced some things that were difficult, and in the midst of that, I would be thankful because I knew that there was something in that trouble or that trial that was to benefit me. So I would thank God for something I really didn't even know what I was thanking Him for. But what I was doing was I was keeping a positive attitude in the midst of that. And that's what Thanksgiving does. It keeps you positive. When you thank your employer for paying you or giving you a job or you're just thankful, it so impacts His life that what He wants to do is He wants to bless you. He may give you more hours on the job. He may give you an increase or may give you a promotion somewhere in the department or however. But there's power in being thankful. And when we complain or when we murmur, it does just the opposite. It's just like cutting someone's knees out from underneath them. And it's never a good result. the impact on that is very negative. But Thanksgiving, and that's the season we're in right now, just to give God thanks for what he's done for us. The pilgrims, they gave God thanks. God bless them. And look at the United States of America now. When they came over, it was nothing but just raw land. There was just nothing here except for the Indians and I guess the animals and buffalo or whatever was here. And but look at this nation now. It is the most powerful nation in the world, and it started off with Thanksgiving, giving God the thanks.
Yeah, it all circles around God. And if we take God out of the equation, then how do we expect to be blessed? How do we expect to continue in this abundance? I mean, so many times in the Bible, we find out when man turns his back from God, God's still there, but he's turned his back. God has never turned his back on
yeah,
man. He's always there for us. And that's one thing that I'm thankful for. It doesn't matter what we do in life. It doesn't matter how far we may drift from God if we end up drifting or if we never knew God in the first place. He's always there. And the second you accept him, the second you ask him, you call upon his name, he's there willing to help you. But that's the thing about God. He puts that in you. Like before I got saved, I wasn't thankful for things. I had things and I wasn't thankful for things. And I came to, before I got saved, I didn't have much, but I had a lot to be thankful for. But I wasn't, I didn't have a thankful attitude. I was pretty ungrateful. If you think about, if you get down to the brass tacks, but God puts that in you. Once you accept that, you have to first thank God, allow him to come into your life, and then, man, it's he puts that willingness, that desire to be thankful to him and towards others, and that in turn blesses God when you're thankful to God, blesses others, like the employer, wife, the people that are really integral in your day-to-day life. If you're thankful to them, man, it's going to be a blessing to them, but it's going to end up being a blessing to you.
You'll be the happiest when you make somebody else happy. And the way you do that is by saying, thank you, thank you. Just think about it. Somebody says to you, thanks for something that you have done. Maybe it's just a little thing, but they say, thank you, I really appreciate that. Just the impact on your life that it makes. You know, I thank God for my health, Mike. Here I am, I'm 70 years old, and I see so many people younger than me that their health is gone. They're struggling in life. But God has been so good to me, and I'm thankful for health. I don't take pills. I don't take medication. I don't take anything other than the Word of God. The Word of God is my medicine, and I just eat regular food, good healthy food. I don't eat junk food, okay? But I eat good healthy food because I know that's what is proper for my body, and I'm thankful. In fact, when I eat, I thank God for my food. I just don't dive into my food. I stop and I hesitate, bow my head, and say, thank you, Lord, for this food. Sanctify it, because I want God to purify the food. If there's anything in that food that shouldn't be in it, it's going to be harmful to me. And the Bible tells us to do that, okay, to pray over our food, because it will sanctify it through prayer and the Word of God. And so purify that. And God has been so good to me. God's given me a sound mind. I mean, my mind. I've got a great church. I mean, it's an amazing church. I've got great people here. Great. I've said a few times, got a beautiful church. We're just in an ugly building. But that's going to change, okay? And I'm thankful for the building. And I've said this to God many times. Thank you, God, for the building that you have given to us. Praise God. It's not the looks of the building that counts. I just thank you for what you have given. You've given us a place here to worship. Praise God. And it's almost paid for. And so we're just saying, thank you, God. We're almost down to the big old goose egg on the payment of this church. Praise God. And I just give God thanks. Give God thanks. And I thank the people. I commend the people for their giving and their willingness to be just a part of Joy Christian Ministries. I'm grateful. I'm thankful, brother.
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, we have so many things to be thankful of. I mean, I think of, like you talked about health. I'm super thankful for my health. I mean, for a while, I wasn't doing too healthy before I got saved. You know, I just felt like I was going to die every day. And at a young age. And then we had a friend that was about my age, same, everything about him was pretty much the same dietary stuff. And he passed away from, you know, stuff that young people shouldn't die of, you know. And it's like, I think it's related to the food, Thanksgiving, because a lot of the food we're eating now, you talked about this last night.
Yeah.
There's so much junk in there. And then you think about it, even when you go out to a restaurant, you don't know what those people are doing when they touch your food. So it's just like, yeah, I'm thankful for health. I thank the Lord every time I eat, because I think that's so integral, because we don't just eat, you know, we don't just live by bread alone, but every word of God. And so when we take the word of God and apply it to our life, even when we're eating, I mean, God receives that. God gets the thanks for that. And we're in turn blessed.
I want us to go out on this segment here in Hebrews. We're in Hebrews. Let's go to the 13th chapter and the 5th and 6th verse, because this is so apropos to what we're talking about here. He said, "Let your conversation be without covetousness, and be content with such things as you have." In other words, be thankful for what you have. "For he has said, I will never leave thee nor forsake thee." The Lord will never let you down, and he will add more to you. He will bless you. He says, "So that we may boldly say," notice this, "the Lord is my helper, and I will not fear what man shall do unto me." Just be thankful. And it's amazing how God will keep you. He will secure you. He will bless you. He'll put you on top, and you'll rise, continue to rise throughout your life. And you'll say, "Thank you, God." Just be thankful. During this season, be reminded, this is a time to say, "Thank you, God. Thank you." Amen. We'll be right back.
All right, we're back, and we're still thankful, still super thankful. I'm going to continue on and just tell you one more thing that I'm thankful for, and I'm just super thankful for, thankful to God for him planting this ministry here, Joy Christian Ministries, right here in West Sacramento. It's been such a life-changing, God changed my life here in this church. This is the church I got saved in, and this is the church my family got saved in, and it's just been such a blessing to me. It's taken me from just where I was at in life to the top, to where I'm at now in life. And it's just, I just look back, and it's so crazy to think that this little building, I don't know if you guys have ever driven by here. I tell people where this place is at all the time, and it's almost like they blow right past it. But we're right here on Sac Avenue on Sunset. Is it Boulevard? Sunset Street? Sunset Avenue.
Sunset Avenue.
And it's the red house. That's why I always tell people, oh, yeah, they know the red house. Yeah. And so, but I tell people, because it's like, man, this church, God's word in this church, and these little four walls in this place that you people pass right by, lives are being changed here. And so I'm super thankful that God put his church here, and God is still here flowing. If the Holy Spirit wasn't here, we're just talking heads. We're just, you can change the channel. There's better stuff on, but the Holy Spirit's here. So don't change the channel.
Yeah, right.
Tune in and hear what we're talking about. Because man, if you do, you're going to be able to live a life that is beyond thankful. You're going to live a life that you can't thank God enough for. And that's what we're living right now. Mm-hmm. And what brings me to this is that recently I was going through some old stuff. I was going cleaning out, you know, just organizing. And, you know, you keep your box of stuff from high school or just, you know, books. And that's what I was going through. I was going through a box of some stuff. There was, like, little notes, little trinkets, all the yearbook. And, you know, in your youth, you write things. Even as a young adult, you'll, like, have different notes or different stuff. And it's like, I was looking through the yearbook, and I was like, man, I was an idiot. I would say stupid things. I would do stupid things. It just brought me back to, man, I used to live just such a wicked life. And I didn't even know it. It was just part of the norm. I was just regular, so to speak. And so, but as I grew into adult, it was from youth, I was just this, I was just dead spiritually. I didn't know God at all. I was just living this sinful, this self-pleasing life that walked all over the name of Jesus, didn't understand what the name of Jesus was, just a life with no hope. A little bit after high school, I remember having this conversation, and if you're hanging out with groups of people that are pleasing their flesh with substances, man, the conversations can go wild and go all over the place. And somehow this conversation got onto the topic of God. And we were talking, and the topic was that God doesn't exist. There is no God. No God. It doesn't matter who thinks whatever God you think you believe in. There's no God whatsoever. You live and you die, and that's it. And after you die, that's it. So don't be weak about it in your head. Be strong and go have fun. Go party. Go do all these things. And man, I subscribe to that. And it was just thinking back on that. It was just so hopeless. Like, that's such a hopeless existence. There's no hope. Yeah. There's no God. So what are you going to hope in yourself? What if you're broken? You're just going to fix yourself? I hear people say that, just pick yourself up. When you're in that broken state, I can tell you from personal experience, you're not just going to pick yourself up. Really? When things have gone down, you've tried everything. And I mean, you've really tried everything, and you're just stuck. That's a hopeless feeling. It's like looking up at the stars in the gutter. Like, yeah. It's you see what's out there, but you know how far away it is. And but man, God brings us back to life. God, in His Word, He tells us when we're in this state, that state that we are in, and that's what I was in, but you may be experiencing. We're all kind of coming from that place of being separated from God. It doesn't matter the exact situation. We're all living in a fallen world, and if you're not with God, man, you're pretty low in life.
Yeah.
And that separation from God, He died before we even knew about that separation for us, not only to be connected with Him again, but for us to be risen with Him. Mm-hmm. And so man, we're going to go to some scriptures that really just illustrate what we're talking about here. So that way you can see God's Word. It's not just me talking. It's just not what my brother's mm-hmm. about to talk about. But man, you can see that this is God's Word spoken to our heart, speaking to my heart as I say it to you. But man, listen up, because God has something for you.
Yeah, we're going to go to Ephesians chapter 2. And we're going to read verses 1 through 6. So chapter 2, verses 1 through 6. And in my version here has a little title. It says, Old Condition, Dead to God. And you hath He quickened, who were dead in trespasses and sins, wherein in time past ye walked according to the course of this world, according to the prince of the power of the air, the spirit that now worketh in the children of disobedience, among whom also we all had our conversation in times past in the lusts of our flesh. Well, it's saying what you were just talking about, these conversations, fulfilling the desires of the flesh and of the mind, and were by nature the children of wrath, even as others. The next title says in my book here, in my Bible here, it says, New Condition, Alive to God. And 4, it says, But God, who is rich in mercy, for His great love wherewith He loved us, even when we were dead in sin, hath quickened us together with Christ. By grace ye are saved, and hath raised up together and made us sit together in heavenly places in Christ Jesus. Wow, this is a crazy dichotomy here that God's given us here on the Word. It's what your nature was prior to Christ, and then boom, your life is partitioned with who you are and what you are and what you live for after you've accepted Christ. And we talk, it says here, among whom also we all had our conversation in times past in the lust of our flesh, fulfilling the desires of the flesh and of the mind. And you said that you're an idiot back when you're a kid. I mean, we can all relate. And if you weren't saved during those times, I can relate. And when you talk about the conversation that you had with those people or those friends or whoever they were at that moment, it seems like the devil just sat down at a desk and wrote the dialogue to that conversation. It is almost a textbook Satan infiltrating these young minds that are so influenced. Because in that conversation, it's easy at that point to, you want to run away from the bad feelings that you're having. You might feel bad about the situation you're in, and you're drinking, or you're consuming some substances, and you run away from your problems and the hurt by, one, excuses, two, deflection, and three, acting as if you had no accountability. And I think that that in that situation as young people, and I have at my time, during my times of being in sin, have probably had those same exact conversations or grappled with the same thing internally. And I find that a lot of the people that say there is no God struggle more with saying there is no God than actually accepting the fact that there is a God. I think that it hurts them worse by saying it, because it's only a deflection. It's only a distraction so they can continue to be in the sin in which the devil wants them to be in. It's an incredible situation to see your life prior to Christ. It is now. I'm coming up on my 10-year high school reunion, which is pretty crazy. And Jessica, we're in the same English class together. She's behind the camera. We graduated the same year. We've known each other since high school. And the people who Jessica and I were at that moment, both being unsaved, and the conversations we had, and the vial that was coming out of our mouths, only we can tell those stories among each other. But we know how we were and how we are now. It is not short of an absolute miracle that we found ourselves in the presence of the Lord every day of our lives, trying to get into the face of God and look into the Word of God, into our prayer to see what God's will is for our life. We, as not only parents, as husbands and wives, as friends, as family members, not only are we a better people, we're also actually something that somebody can look up to or look towards for truth. It doesn't matter how young you are or what you did in your past or what your family knows about in your past. What's the important thing is to see the change. The change is the most important thing.
And also on top of that, the most important thing even beyond that is who made the change. Ooh. Who made that change possible? Who made that change possible to where we can now be thankful for what he did? And it's God. And that first verse, man, when I was reading this and I was going through my study, this one hit me hard. And I will say it to you because that's what God was saying to me. And it says, and you hath he quickened. You are the one that he brought back to life. That word quickened there, it means brought back to life. It means if a person was dead, they did CPR, they did something, and then poof, that's being quickened. They're back to life. And that's exactly what God did for us. And you hath he quickened who were dead in trespasses and sins. You were so polluted with sins, they held you down. You couldn't go anywhere. You were flatlined. But because of God, he brought you back. He brought you back, and now you're stronger than ever. Stronger than ever. And if anybody out there that thinks that you don't have anything to be thankful for, man, that this fourth verse was hitting me, letting me know to let you know, but God. If you think that if you can say, I don't have anything to be thankful for, you know, and people say, oh, but, and that's what I'm saying. But God is the reason for you to be thankful for all things. Like I was telling you, I was so down and out in my life. I was like, I gave you that analogy of laying in the gutter and looking up at the stars. But God is the one in that moment that still allowed me to continue to breathe, though I wasn't breathing spiritually because, like I told you, I was dead. Just like this scripture, this is not just talking about me. This is talking about anybody that's disconnected, that does not have a born-again relationship with Christ. Those people, they're dead in sins and trespasses, and they're separated from God. But it says here, but God, who is rich in mercy, for his great love wherewith he loved us. That's all it takes, is God's love to pull us up out of that situation and up to sit with him. Like it says in that sixth verse, it says, and hath raised us up together and made us to sit together in heavenly places in Christ Jesus. That situation that you're living in, that situation that you think is life, you think that is life, that's not life. That's not life, because Christ here is giving us life. Christ wants us to sit together. It doesn't say he's going to put us somewhere. He says, no, we're going to sit together with Christ in heavenly places, places far better than what you can see in this temporal world. We're talking eternal stuff. God is promising us here stuff that lasts forever, not something that, oh yeah, I'll do this for you, and those people let us down. No, Christ put his life, he gave his life mm-hmm. on that cross. He bled completely so the power of his blood can wash you cleaner than snow, whiter than snow.
Yeah, and I just want to put a little disclaimer on this segment here, is that at the time that this airs, we probably have a new president, and whoever that person is, it doesn't matter what their policies are, what direction they're going to take this country in. Here's the truth. Here's what's the only important thing, is that God is still on the throne. God is still in control. And we talk about our sinful lives before Christ. And if you're sitting there and you don't know Christ, you're not a despicable person. You're not you're not hopeless. Okay, you're a good person. You were created in the image of your Father, but you're not living according to his purpose. And what that takes is just an acceptance of Jesus Christ as your personal Savior, asking him to forgive you of your sins, and then making a 180 in your life and going towards him and living a holy, righteous life. It's really hard sometimes for new Christians to ask for things because they think it's being selfish from God. But the best thing that you can do, the least selfish thing you can do, is ask God for salvation and for you to be forgiven of your sins. And what's an easy way during this time of Thanksgiving, an easy prayer that I found always comes very easy, is a prayer of thanksgiving to God, because you know the things that you have and the things that you, in the situation you could be in. And a lot of you could be dead. You know of the situation, you're thinking of it right now, where you could have been dead or worse off, but you're alive. And you're listening to Joy and watching Joy Christian Ministry, Joy TV right now, and you're hearing his word and you have an opportunity. So thank God for that. And we'll see you in the next segment. Welcome back. And as you know, throughout this television program, we're just giving thanks to God. We're glorifying God, and not only our testimonies, allowing ourselves to become vulnerable for the benefit of not only the people in this room, but everyone that's paying attention here, watching Joy TV. It's hard to become vulnerable and really talk about something that's really tough. But when the end is so good and it's something to be so thankful for, it makes it all the better. It's like watching that movie that looks like it's going to be a train wreck at the end, and then it's happily ever after. And you're walking out of the movie theater with a smile, and you're like, man, that was such a great movie. I want to see it again and again and again. And in our testimonies, not only through the tough times, the trying times, but also the good times, we give God thanks no matter what. We glorify God no matter what. And in our lives, our hope is in the Lord. We need to put our hope in everything that we that we are made of, our mind, our strength, into God. And having living according to His purpose and what He wants for our life. God doesn't want you to be fearful. God doesn't want you to be angry. God doesn't want you to be depressed. God doesn't want you to be addicted. God doesn't want you to be shackled to whatever you serve on a daily basis that is holding you back from your goals, your dreams, and most importantly, serving Him. He wants you to have a purpose in your life and being driven by that purpose. And that purpose is the end result, the symptom, the manifestation of living according to His purpose. It comes out in joy. It comes out in peace. It comes out with love, love that's overflowing in your life. And people see that. People see the result of living a purposed life that's focused on God. And like I said, God, He is not the author of confusion. He doesn't want you to hang on to untruth and then try and believe the truth. You have to let go of that untruth that you live for before, that was a desire of the flesh that led you to death. But He wants you to live in the truth. The truth is in the Word of God. The Word of God is going to give you a direction, is going to give you not only documentation of the sacrifice in which Jesus Christ made on Calvary for our sins, but also give us documentations of stories and testimonies of godly people that went through the darkest moments that anyone can ever dream up. And they went through it, the most painful situations. But what is common in the Word of God is that all those people gave glory to God no matter what. And so in that situation, and reading those and allowing those to absorb in my spirit, it reinforces my faith that in the bleak times, like I shared with you, and things that are going to come in the future, because I do have an enemy, we all have an enemy that's going to come after us, that those stories are something I can hold on to. Those documentations are what I can hold on to and be thankful for, and that I can then... it can encourage me to push through. So that's not only the purpose of the documentation of the stories that are in the Bible and the gospel of Christ, but also what we're trying to do here on Joy TV. Live a purposed life, and the result will be joy and peace.
Yeah, that purpose-driven life. God gives us a purpose. And it's just, it's impossible to be unthankful when you realize that, wow, I'm not just a product of circumstance. I didn't just happen, and even if my parents didn't quite plan for me, I'm in no way an accident. God has planned my life. God has purpose for my life. He has a calling for my life. And man, it's impossible to be unthankful that God has just picked you out, called you for something amazing, even far more amazing than you think you're capable of. I know God's called me for something more amazing than what I'm even thinking that I'm capable of. He called Moses, and Moses, it's funny, you read about Moses, and God's like, no, you're going to do this. And Moses is like, no, look, I'm all that good. Like, you might want to pick somebody else, because I'm the last person that should be doing this. Just like when Pastor JC asked me to be on the TV show, I was like, I'm the last person you want on the TV show. Like, but it doesn't matter. If God has a calling on your life, He's going to move you in areas that you think weren't possible. But with Him, all things are possible, especially if God's willed them for your life.
Yeah. So. And you know, praying for the simplest of things. When you think of the simple things, the things you don't think about, your heart beating in your chest, the breath that you're breathing and staying alive and being able to stand on your own two feet, those are complicated things only God can work out. And those are things that you can be thankful for. If you think that there's nothing to be thankful for, be thankful for the heartbeat that just beat in your chest right before that thought came in your head. And then start to build your faith in God and be thankful not only for the simple things, and then start to thank God for the crazy things that we just don't understand.
Yeah. 2 Timothy, the first chapter, and we're going to read verses 7 through 9. It says here, "For God hath not given us the spirit of fear, but of power and of love and of a sound mind. Be not therefore ashamed of the testimony of our Lord, nor of me, his prisoner, but be thou partaker of the afflictions of the gospel according to the power of God, who hath saved us and called us with a holy calling, not according to our works, but according to his own purpose and grace, which was given us in Christ Jesus before the world began." There's nothing you can do to earn what God has done for you. There's nothing you can do to earn God's grace. You can't buy it. The purpose, you can't create your own. You can't negotiate with God. God has created you before the world began. He has a purpose for your life. And there's nothing that you can do to get God to not love you. There's nothing that you can do that you have done to get God to be so angry at you that he won't accept you if you come to him and say, "Lord, I want you to be my Lord. I want you to be God. I want you, I want you." It says here, it doesn't matter what you did in the past, and it doesn't matter what you do to try to earn something. It says, "And not according to our works." So in my case, I don't think I can ever, some people think, "Oh, definitely I can earn it." But for me, I feel that I am so unworthy to even be speaking to you guys. But it's not according to my works. It's not according to what I'm able to do in my physical sense with my mind, but it's what God's called us to do. And it says anything that God calls you to do, when it's truly God's calling, it's a holy calling or a good thing. God's going to call you not to do bad stuff, but to do good stuff. I know of some people that I've talked to, and it just, I feel like almost they think, just the way they talk, that it's a little bit of time that passes before they're right back into what they're doing. But it feels like they're only good at doing this thing. They're only good at stealing stuff, or they're only good at like hurting people. That's like, and they almost get to the point where it's like, "Oh, well, that's what I was created to do. That's what I'm good at." Yeah. That's not true. That's not true at all.
It's such a lie.
It's such a lie. And it's so, like I talked about earlier, I bought into a lie. I thought there was no God. Mm. That's buying into a lie. The devil is tricking people into buying into lies. And we're here today, me and my brother are here today. We subscribe to the lie, but no longer. We subscribe to the truth, and we've dedicated our lives to give that truth to you. The holy calling that God's put on our lives, and the holy calling that God's put on your lives too. There's a calling for every single person, different callings, unique callings. It's your calling that God has called you to do.
Yeah, you know, I dumped that subscription a long time ago.
Yeah,
kind of like a newspaper. We don't need them anymore, you know. we have everything that we need online, but I dumped that subscription. Subscribing to the fact that fear has to drive our lives, and that discontent is what is the great motivator. But it's not. It's the fact of fulfilling the purpose that God has set before you and said, "This is what you're supposed to be doing. This is how I need you or want you to live your life, and you have a choice." That's what's great about God, is that, and why he created a creation that is, it's valuable because of the garden and everything, the iniquities that have been passed down and the devil's working towards us. But it's also a beautiful creation because we can make a choice. We can make a choice to subscribe to God and serve him and live everlasting life in heaven, or we can decide to reject God, and it leads to death and destruction. And I can tell you this now, I'm thankful for God being on the throne. I'm thankful for Jesus Christ being at his right hand, interceding for you and I. And I'm so thankful for the sweet Holy Spirit that just coats this earth, that is just pushing us towards Jesus Christ, our comforter, God's presence. And I thank God for you, and I thank God for my brother.
I thank God for the same thing. I thank God for just people that are watching. I'm super encouraged to hear that when people walk up to me, they say, "Hey, I've been watching your show, it's good stuff," or "Yeah, I need to go to church." just that, that's not me speaking to you, that's God speaking to you. That's God putting something into you. I can tell you to come to church, but it's that voice that you hear at 2 o'clock in the morning that makes you feel a certain way that really gets you in here.
Yeah.
And I just thank God for that. I thank God for working in the lives of the people. I thank God for allowing me to be example to my family, to my friends, to my brother, and to ultimately be an example to you guys watching on the show. I don't want to be a fraud. I want to live my life the real deal. And I thank God for allowing me to do just that. So thank you for tuning in. It's been an awesome show. That's an hour. So until next time, I'm Mike.
I'm Russell.
And this is Joy TV. And don't you ever forget, the joy of the Lord is your strength.
Happy Thanksgiving.